television plays a big role. When I started practicing law, a lot of times in criminal cases, lawyers would make allusions to Perry Mason, and that the person coming in would be the person who would then admit to the crime. And prosecutors would say, it's not like Perry Mason. And then it went through all those permutations of L.A. law and Ally McBeal and all these various criminal sort of shows that are on. And now with the CSI factor, I think it's gone up to a much higher level because there's so much more of those shows on TV and people following them and watching them all the time. If someone was starting new in my profession as a prosecutor, I would tell them they need to be aware of a CSI factor. They need to be aware that the jurors might be anticipating when they're coming into that courtroom that they're going to get a lot more scientific evidence than they will. And the younger lawyer needs to explain why they're not getting it in a particular case. I think the way this whole CSI effect, this whole media onslaught makes our job different is that you do have to anticipate what's going to happen. First on TV, you watch almost every night there's a CSI type show, and then on the reruns and on the cable networks. And so that our jury pool, one of the things about the criminal justice system, of course, is that it's mainly made up of professionals, but the most important people are the jurors who come in, and they're not professionals. And so we don't know all the time what they're thinking, what they're watching. And so today, the odds are they're watching one of those shows or many of those shows. The concern we would have in jurors watching the shows is because we don't know too much about them, we always have to assume that they will be watching these shows, that they will have a sort of idea about what we can do forensically, whether it's realistic or not. So we always think about that, and you have to be prepared for that. Okay. The CSI show and all its progeny have really brought in science into the courtroom, into those programs, and that is a first. Before that, it was more, much more dramatic, the Perry Mason type thing where the real murderer is sitting in the back and Perry Mason points to him and says, that's the person, much more eyewitness identification. Now it's very much, is there DNA? Is there photo enhancement? Are there fingerprints? All of that type of stuff is going to play a much bigger role. And we anticipate it's just going to keep getting more and more complicated and more where a jury, you're going to just have to think, what are their expectations? One of the big differences between CSI and those type of programs on television and what really happens at a crime scene is the real lack of emotion and what's occurring. If you have a murder scene, you have a horrific accident, many times it's pandemonium. Law enforcement's coming on, trying to ascertain what happened, trying to keep everybody away. Sometimes they're effective, sometimes they're not. We've seen in some highly publicized cases where the crime scene was contaminated. On programs like CSI, they'll usually come to a murder. Everybody's just, you know, looking so well. You know, everything's working just fine. And it's really not like that in life. As the prosecutor, you're now trying to recreate it later within a courtroom. And you're trying to get who the witnesses are. Sometimes it's very hard just to ascertain who is there. In some cases, we would have to present more evidence to make a point. And the O.J. Simpson case, for instance, was a very highly watched media event. And as a result of that, I think a lot of prosecutors, a lot of law enforcement changed some of what they did. They were trying to move forward and thinking about, what, as technology changes, will the CSI effect become stronger or greater to us? It's so hard to quantify it. It's almost impossible at this stage. I don't think there's sufficient data. But it behooves the prudent prosecutor to know it's out there and be aware of it and think about, in a particular case, why we don't have any scientific evidence, why we were not able to put any together, why law enforcement and the investigative team did not do certain steps, and be ready to explain that. Because also, I think jurors are smarter today. And so they're sitting there, they're well educated, and they're saying, well, why didn't you dust this for fingerprints? And if we can explain why we didn't, because the surface was no good, it will make a lot of sense to them. If we can't explain it, they will hold that against us, and rightfully so. Examples of cases in which it seems that we do worry about a CSI type effect. A good example might be there's a robbery and there's video, whether from the store or from the street. The video is almost always very grainy, very spotty, very hard to make out even that it was a human being, let alone male or female, let alone real identifying information. We will try to get that enhanced, and we will try to get that video so that it's better to be viewed. It never works. It never gets any better. On CSI, they put that video in, and they get closer and closer. It's, you can read the license plate perfect. You can see a mole on someone's cheek, and it just doesn't work like that. So in opening statement during voir dire, you will try to explain to the jury, look, you know, we've done certain things, and again in closing argument, we did what we could, but it doesn't work like it does on TV. One of the things you'll see on television a lot through the CSI programs is they'll do a DNA sort of analysis, and they'll use CODIS or one of the other programs, and immediately they'll pop up a name and a face. And, you know, it doesn't happen that way, and it just, as anybody who's been involved in DNA knows, it simply gives you a sort of framework and a population survey and how many people could possibly fit in that. And of course, if it's one in several billion, it's tremendous evidence and it really works good, but it's much more scientific, much more technological, and much tougher to do than just the way they do it in the television shows. So that's something, again, many times we will say to the jurors, okay, this isn't television, and we'll start that from voir dire. We'll mention that in opening statement. We'll bring it through with the witnesses, and again in closing argument to let them know that it doesn't work like it does on TV. It's just not that simple. One of the things that happens today is when we have forensic witnesses, we wind up asking them questions about things that didn't even happen in anticipation that the defense will be cross-examining them in those areas. For instance, a forensic specialist might be up there and we'll ask why he or she didn't do A and B and C. And that's not even an issue. And a jury might be looking at that and wondering why we're doing that. But that's to sort of take the steam out of the defense attorney when he or she goes into it and says, hey, why didn't you do these things? They still will, but we've brought out a plausible explanation for that. So we want to be very careful. And we're finding more and more of that because we have to answer with forensic technicians and examiners why they didn't do certain tests that are commonplace on television that are so easy to do. You know, for instance, one of the things you'll see many times on TV is they'll have a thumbprint or and they put it in a machine and out pops the defendant's face and all his identifying data. And that just doesn't happen. And we need to explain that that's entertainment. We're going to look at it. We're going to have fun watching these TV shows, but it's not real life. One facet of the CSI effect that you really have to address is in your closing argument. That's the time where the prosecutor can explain away deficiencies in a case and highlight the strengths of a case. So for instance, if it's a particular case with very little forensics, you're going to have to explain that today to a jury why we don't have that. If we have a lot, you're going to have to make that forensics understandable to the average juror. DNA is a very complicated process, and if your witness is a lab rat who knows the material tremendously but doesn't bring that forth to the jury, we're going to have some issues. So the prosecutor at the end has to tie that all together, and it's really up to that prosecutor to put that all together, the science, the technology, the eyewitness testimony, that all comes down then at the closing argument. And today you're going to have to spend some time on the technology and explain it away to the jury.